Vroom, vroom, vroom. We are back. This one's going to be fast-paced and action-packed. Welcome back to What's Your Mount Rushmore. This is going to be a fun episode. It's a really cool, just dude episode. Sorry, ladies, but it still will be interesting if you're into what we're about to talk about. I'm one of the hosts of this lovely, lovely podcast. My name is Mark Duvel.
And I'm the other guy over here, John Hansen. And yeah, you are absolutely right, Mark. This will be a fun one. You know, there might be some ladies that can appreciate this one as well, but today what we're going to be doing is counting out our favorite dream cars. And it's going to be, I mean, this is going to be a lot of fun because, you know, you and I both like cars, and I did want to preface one thing before we really do jump into this. Mark and I are not gearheads. We're not going to be breaking down engine displacement and the transmissions and the gear ratios of a 1970 Oldsmobile. I mean, that's not what... It's not what we do here, right?
Well, anything that I'm about to talk about in my four picks, I just simply want to own one and drive one. I don't want to fix it.
Let me tell you what Melba Toast is packing right here. I've got 411 Posi Track Outback, 750 double pumper, Edelbrock intakes, Ford over 30, 11-to-1 pop-up pistons, turbojet, 390 horsepower. We're talking some fucking muscle.
Yes. I don't want to, you know, change the spark plugs. I don't even want to change the oil.
I don't even want to know where the spark plugs are, to be honest with you. I mean, for one thing, for all of these, they'd be very hard to change the spark plugs because they're fancy cars.
Yeah. When it comes to like man points, when it comes to like cars and wrench heads. Yeah. I'm docked about 500 points.
Yeah.
When it comes to man points, I don't have them in this department.
Yeah.
But I still very much appreciate the topic, and I definitely appreciate, you know, the vehicles that are on my list. I'm really excited to hear what you came up with because as we get going, I mean, I tried to kind of categorically narrow it down to one to make up my four from different categories of types of vehicles. So
yeah,
I'm excited to hear what you got. So why don't you get things rolling and we'll get the show on the road.
Yeah, literally. Yeah, let's do it. I see what you did there. So, yeah, I've mentioned on this podcast a couple of times in the past that I'm a big fan of the TV show Magnum P.I., the original. And one of the reasons I love that show is the friggin' car. I mean, come on. It's he has a Ferrari 308 GTS. And they actually used three different versions, three different years of Ferraris over the course of the series run because the show was on for, I think, 8 years or so. But the 1980 version was the one that had the, you know, was in the most episodes. It's probably the one that you kind of think of the most in terms of the show. You know, we're here to talk about cars, so I'm not going to go on too much about the show, but I did have one kind of funny point that I was going to make. The producers of that show originally wanted a Porsche in that car, in the show. They wanted Magnum to drive a Porsche.
Really?
Yeah, Ferrari wasn't on their radar at first. So they went to the, you know, the manufacturer and Porsche, and Porsche said, you know what, we do not make modifications to our cars. Our no matter who the customer is, whether it's Joe Schmo or some Hollywood producer, you're getting what you get. You know, when you buy a Porsche, this is what you're getting. And they said, well, that's not going to work for us because Tom Selleck is 6'4". We have to modify it. You know, he's not going to fit in a little sports car, at least not very comfortably. So they ended up going to Ferrari, and Ferrari's like, hell yeah, we'll do it. They adjusted the seats. They moved him backwards. They did things with the steering. They made all kinds of changes to fit him. And then look at this. All these years later, that Ferrari is iconic from the 80s. I mean, it's one of the most iconic TV cars of all time. And Porsche missed out on that. On that easy marketing, you know, campaign.
Shame on you, Porsche. They approached Porsche, and Porsche said, sorry, we cannot accommodate a man with that much chest hair and that much mustache.
Yes, too much mustache for us.
Fabricators can't work around that, so sorry, go to Ferrari. They're into that kind of thing.
And, you know, Ferrari is Italian. They have no problem with chest hair and mustaches. So it was a good fit, actually.
Look at that. Sometimes the square peg does fit in the square hole, whatever that just meant.
Huh?
One other quick thing I was going to say about it before I throw it back to you for your first pick. Another Ferrari I would not turn down. It's not on my list. It's the 1961 250 GT California Spider. And do you have any idea why that particular Ferrari has significance? A 1961 California GT Spider.
I'm going to have to go with my gut and say that's the Ferris Bueller vehicle.
Yes.
There we go.
that is exactly right. Extremely rare. They made a bunch of those, the 308 GTSs that were used in the Magnum show, but the 61 California GT, they did not make very many of those. And to this day, they're extremely rare. In fact, just a couple of years ago, one of them sold for $17 million.
Holy shit stick.
That's how rare and special they are. So,
wow.
So yeah, like I said, I wouldn't turn that one down either, but anyway, I'd be happy with any Ferrari. Let's be honest.
Yeah. And like your Magnum PI Ferrari, Ferraris are so tied to being like traditionally red.
Yes.
I mean, I know everyone always will think of a little red Corvette, but Ferraris, I don't know. They're just associated with having a red Ferrari. I mean, it's like a status thing.
Yeah. And if I were to have a Ferrari, I'd want it in red. That's very true. Yeah,
I agree. And that's what's funny. So I'm going to jump into my pick, and I'm actually going to go I'm going to start old school. And when I say old school, I'm going to go back to 1932. So my first pick is a 1932 Cadillac V16 Sport Phaeton. And this is such a unique car. And if you don't, and this, you know what, I'm going to real quickly, this is an episode that it's probably not going to be a bad idea to get your Google machine out. And because I don't expect, you know, when we start saying these specific models, people aren't going to be able to, oh, yeah, I know exactly what that looks like.
Yeah.
But on this one, I would recommend Google what we're talking about, because these vehicles, at least, again, I don't know everything that's about to come out of your mouth, but I can already tell with where you're starting. I'm not surprised with your Magnum PI pick, but these are really visual things. So please follow, you know, don't check these out. These are cool. But a 1932 Cadillac V16, you know, Sport. There was only a little over 4,000 of these made. Hmm. It's like the ultimate mafia gangster car.
Yes.
If you know what I mean. It's like a really long scoop hood. The big dramatic wheel wells. Just very gangster in that way. And they were made in Detroit. They were only made for 11 years. And it was known as like the most luxurious, finest pre-war vehicle. From that era. And like I said, and only a little over 4,000 of these were made, but man, they're so cool. And they're just so classy looking. And I kind of went back and forth between this car and like a Rolls Royce to represent this like style of something that has always kind of captured my interest. But ultimately I wanted to go with the Cadillac, and it's such a cool looking vehicle. And it came in both, you know, you could get a hard top or a convertible. And just a fun, I would love to have a vehicle like this just for those Sunday cruises.
Oh, yeah.
No matter where you would go with something like this, you're going to turn heads. But you know what? I'll stop right there. Probably everything we're going to talk about is a head turner. I can't imagine, unless you have like a 1989 Ford Escort in royal blue. Those also turned a lot of heads, especially... especially with the ladies.
Hi, baby.
hey, don't spoil my later picks. What are you doing here? Come on. What a dick.
So, but yeah, I'm going to come out of the gate with class, you know, in history.
Man, those Cadillacs were very, very cool in the 30s. They did have that gangster look. You're right. And there were a couple other U.S. manufacturers like Packard made some really cool luxury cars in that same era. And it's interesting, too, because in the 30s, the Depression had hit, and most people, very few people could afford those cars anymore. So they became that much more special and that much more rare because they just didn't make as many of them. Because
that's that's why only 4,000 were made. Not many people were in the market to, you know, drop that kind of money at the time. You know, when all they're trying to do is, you know, find bread and water for their family during that era.
You had to be a president of a company, maybe a Hollywood star or a badass gangsta to be able to afford one of those things. But that's a cool pick. I got no problem with that. And you mentioned something about people using their old Google machine. The other thing I would tell people too, if you listen to us on Spotify or Apple Podcast, we also have a YouTube channel. And when we put our videos on YouTube, we'll throw pictures of these things up on our YouTube video. So
that's true. Good point.
If you're too damn lazy to Google, just go and watch our video, watch this episode on YouTube, and you'll see good pictures of all these vehicles too. So.
And even better, you don't see us. You'll just see the images. Yeah. You don't get to watch our crazy asses blobbing into a microphone.
Nope. You will not. So anyway, cool. Okay. Awesome. A couple of great picks on the board. A couple of solid ones. Got a nice sporty import and an American luxury car. And I'm going to go back to, well, actually, this is an American car, but I guarantee you it's one that you and probably our listeners have never even heard of. It's a Hennessy Venom F5. and here's where you insert the sound effect. What? It's yeah. because like, yeah, I get that nobody really knows what this is. It's actually a car that I first saw this car on Jay Leno's Garage. By side note, have you ever watched that show, Jay Leno's Garage?
I have. I've caught a few, and it's amazing, his collection, no doubt about it.
Yeah, and it is. The thing about his show is that show is, it's not just about his collection. He highlights all kinds of cars on that show, you know, not just supercars, but also just everyday classics and things. But anyway, that was a great show. I think it's off the air now, unfortunately, but I watched a lot of those episodes. So the Venom F5 is classified as a hypercar, which is a step above a supercar. You know, when you talk about supercars like Ferraris and Lamborghinis, the hypercars are ones that are just designed to break records. I mean, that's what it is. And this sumbitch does just that.
Wow.
This the top speed on this sucker is 301 miles an hour.
Holy shit.
Is it? I mean, 301. Yep.
Wow. And
this car is so fast, they don't calculate. It's like 0 to 60 times because the stopwatch doesn't turn on and off fast enough to do that. That calculate the time. There's actually a 0 to 250 miles an hour time on this car, and it does it in a little under 20 seconds. So about the time it's taking me to say that sentence, you could be going 250 miles an hour in one of these beasts,
with a whole lot of piss on your legs.
Gross.
I'm built to do that.
No. And then from there it goes up. I mean, you can top out at 300 miles an hour in this car. They only built 24 of them. And they sold them. The average price was around $1.8 million. They were very specialty cars that they built them for the people that wanted to buy them, basically custom to each person. And it was about 3 or 4 years ago they built them, and they haven't come back to make any more since. It was kind of a one-time thing. This is the interesting thing about this car. Each of the vehicles, you know, like your vehicles, my cars at home, they have a key fob to let you in and out. Well, the key fob that comes with this is steel plated. And it's got a serial number, you know, built in. You know, obviously, the serial numbers are either 1 through 24 because they only made 24 of them.
Yeah.
But the steel that they used for these fobs, somehow they got these from the retired space shuttle program, the steel. So all of these pieces of all these key fobs have actually been in space on the space shuttle. So
what a weird little detail. Oh, my God.
Well, I mean, if you're going to spend almost $2 million on a car, I suppose they kind of go out of the way to find unique things that make that car special. So, yeah. So everyone has their key fob is made out of shit that's been in space. So
that's pretty wild. Wow. And I am familiar with this car, and I know what it looks like. It's kind of one of those, like, when you think of an exotic car. I mean, there's always going to be, the immediate people will gravitate to, you know, Ferraris, Lamborghinis. But this is one of those vehicles people, it would turn heads, but they probably wouldn't exactly know immediately what it is. They just know it's something incredibly expensive and very fast.
And Hennessy has nothing to do with the cognac. Completely different company.
I was just going to say,
I'm sure you were wondering.
There's some blurred lines.
at 301 miles per hour.
My God. Well, you know what? I'll run with mine. My next pick, I'm going to just stay in that little lane there, and I'm going to give you my exotic car choice. Mine is, again, when you're talking about a rare vehicle, only 10 of these were made, and this is a 2019 Bugatti Cento Dieci.
Huh?
Dieci. Cento Dieci. It's an Italian Bugatti exotic sports car.
Yeah.
Again, please, if these are not going to be something that people can just probably pull from their memory, so please look this up. But here's what's crazy about these: only 10 of them were made. So again, I stress the word. This is our dream list. So I mean, shoot, go big or go home, right? Well, 10 of them were made, and they sell for a measly $10 million a pop.
Great cash, homie.
Jeez.
Now they have the look. They are incredibly unique looking. I don't know it doesn't have those like dramatic wheel wells the way that like a Lamborghini or your Hennessy does. But man, it looks like it's a vehicle that would just destroy the road. It doesn't quite have the performance of what you were just talking about, but it's damn close. Obviously this is like a gold standard car, you know, for that type of genre of a vehicle, considering it's a $10 million, you know, vehicle. But it does, you know, the whole You were saying yours is so fast they don't record it 0 to 60. This one, the stats on it, it does go 0 to 60 in 2.4 seconds. Think about that for a second, and goes 0 to 124 in 6.1. Wow. I think it can max out somewhere over the 250. That's why when you said they only measure yours 0 to 250, 20 seconds. I'm like, what? What? But this is, it's just an ultimate, just stealthy looking, just like comic book type Batmobile. I love the car, but I also really wanted to again test my ability to say the word.
Say it again.
Cento dieci.
I think you nailed it.
Hey valet, where's my cento dieci?
yeah, okay, you're gonna give that to a valet.
Nope.
some stoner kid. Oh, I got it over here somewhere.
Talk about Ferris Bueller reference. It'd be the same exact thing that would happen. You throw a valet keys to something like that. Oh, my God. You better file an insurance claim right there on the spot. My God. Well, so that's my exotic car choice. Now, I got to ask, with your Hennessy, do you have a color that you would specifically go with? We talked about your Ferrari clearly being red. What would it be for your exotic one?
I think I liked black in that. I have seen them in a few different colors, but black looked kind of badass to me.
Ironically, the same. The Cento Dieci would be black, yes.
If they only made 10 of them, I mean, I wonder what colors were made. Do you have any idea?
They were made in white, black, I believe yellow, and I think red.
I don't really like white or yellow, but I could take black or red in one of those, I suppose.
Yeah. And again, it's a really attractive, obviously, it better be for $10 million. No, it's a really cool looking car, but yeah, that covers my that type of car. So,
all right,
look at you. You're already on your third pick. So, what flavor is next?
My last two picks are both American icons. The first one is a muscle car of the American icon style. It's a 1970 Ford Mustang, but it's not just any 70 Mustang. It is the Boss 429 Mustang.
That's such a cool car.
Oh God, yeah. They are. I mean, honestly, that's probably, if I'm picking one car that I could drive and own on my list, obviously, you know, sure, the multi-million dollar cars would be cool, but let's be realistic. This is probably the one that would be the one that I would be my first choice. That's a little bit more realistic. Probably not realistic for me in my current financial state, however, but maybe.
We are taking donations on our hotline.
Always.
Are those phone lines open over there?
Always. Yes. No calls.
John is Mustang.
We're not getting any calls yet? No? Okay. All right. We can. Phones are not lighting up. Anyway, wait,
we do have a call. Sir, what's your name?
Hey, tell him to go fuck himself.
Hang up on that prick. God, we got to get a better call screener.
Yeah. That guy is clearly not a fan.
Oh, not at all. But what I am a fan of are these Mustangs. Ford they made less than 500 of these. So they're really, really rare. They only made about 850 of them in 1969. So between the 60, the Boss 429s were only made for 2 years anyway. So you either have a 69 or a 70. And I would probably go with Grabber Blue. That was the color that these came in. They actually came in Grabber Blue, Raven Black, and Candy Apple Red were the three main colors for these Boss 429s. And the Grabber Blue was the cool color that I liked. Because they're so rare, in mint condition in recent years, they actually have sold for upwards of $300,000. So it is definitely an expensive car. It's not on the level of a Ferrari or a, you know, international supercar. But as far as muscle cars go, it's definitely one of the most expensive you can get. They did make also 302 Boss Mustangs, which were much more common, a little bit smaller engine, of course, the 429 engine versus the 302, that's the engine size. Those are more attainable. You can get those for less than 100,000 in mint condition, but and I wouldn't turn one of those down either. They're also badass, just a little bit less of an engine.
It's funny because traditionally I'm not really, and you are, so you're a huge Mustang guy. I mean, in fact, I know you've owned Mustangs.
Yep.
And of all the you know, muscle car that era of Ford Mustangs, I would say that this would be my favorite, even over the one they call Eleanor. I think I'm thinking of is the one from the movie Gone in 60 Seconds with Nick Cage.
Yeah. Right?
But I like the one you're talking about, the one you picked. I like that more than that. Like the one that's in that movie, Gone in 60 Seconds, it's cool. Don't get me wrong. I'd take it. But the one you're talking about, it just looks truly like a muscle car.
They are definitely powerful, and they sound mean as hell. 1970, most people kind of agree, was the peak of the muscle car era, because after 1970, they started to go downhill. Cars, the engines, it having to do with regulations, with what you could put in it. Cars, the government came up with these regulations for conserving gas, and the 70s were kind of a bleak time for muscle cars. So after 1970, it went downhill, but the late 60s to 1970, lots of badass cars in that mix.
It's funny, you literally just parted the sea for this transition, because my next pick, it's a muscle car, and it is from 1970.
Oh.
And so here I go. Here's my third pick. It's a 1970 Pontiac GTO, and the one that's called The Judge.
Oh, yeah.
For those of you who love this movie, which I certainly do, it's very much featured in the movie Dazed and Confused. And if you know the movie, it's the character named Pickford. It's his car. And when you start the movie, it's actually one of the first things you see. It's what they call Orbit Orange is the color of this car. And to start that movie, it's just trolling really slowly through the high school parking lot while Aerosmith is playing. And it's what really kind of starts the movie, and it grabs you immediately. But again, we're focusing on the car in this circumstance, not the movie, but because I could, like, once I start talking about Dazed and Confused, you won't be able to shut me up.
All right.
But here's the thing. I'm going to be very specific. So it's that car, that color, Orbit Orange. But what made these very rare, and this is, look how slim this gets. I'm talking about the convertible version of that car. Only 168 were made. And of that 168, only 17 of them were made with the 455 V8 Ram Air 4 intake, which means that, you know, it has that much more little kick in the pants. And then there was only 7 of those. So 7 total of the one that I'm actually picking that are all the what I just said, but with an automatic transmission. So what's crazy about this is, ironically, last year in 2023, down in Kissimmee, Florida, there was a huge auto auction. And the very car that I'm talking about, the 1970 Pontiac GTO The Judge, and it is a convertible with an automatic transmission and the big intake, blah, 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 it sold for $1 million.
Wow.
It is the most expensive sale of any Pontiac vehicle on record.
Jeez.
So, wow. And again, I'm not, it wouldn't, for me to pick this, again, we're focusing on the word dream car. I would take the Judge of any option. But if I'm going to get specific, I might as well pick the one that's $1 million, or at least sold for that recently.
If you're dreaming,
some old guy who has like the world's largest collection of Pontiac vehicles, he's the one who sold it. Wow. And he couldn't believe it. He actually had a reserve on it of $800,000. So it shows you how much he put value in it. And he bought it literally as a young kid.
Wow.
If I could really, like, I'd be so proud to drive around a GTO they're just, again, they're one of those like classic cars that just represent that era, you know, like a Mustang, like a GTO, like a Chevelle. You know, and I had a hard time not choosing a Chevelle SS. And a quick side story, for those of you who have now listened to a few of our past episodes, you'll clearly pick up on the fact that it's how John and I became friends. We used to work in radio together. And one of the radio stations I used to work at was a classic rock station. The station itself sucked ass as far as ratings. And it is what it is. I'm just calling
it. Not your fault. Not your fault.
No.
No.
And certainly not my fault after you hear this idea. So, and again, I won't drone on about it. But with that being a classic rock station, I did come up with an idea the radio station's call letters were WLOL. And I then, you know, went to upper management and said, give me some money. I think I can turn an opportunity into for us to sell some sponsorships, and I want to buy a Chevelle, and we'll call it the WLOL Chevelle, and we'll put stickers on it. We'll make sure it's painted up cool, which we ended up getting it. This happened, and it was a yellow Chevelle with the black racing stripes, and we did sell a ton of sponsors, and it made like appearances throughout an entire summer. And then ultimately we did a drawing. You could register to win this thing, and we did give it away. It looked great on the outside. The inside was a little rough around the edges because I wasn't given a huge budget to go find a Chevelle. So I had to buy it sight unseen from somewhere in upstate New York, and it was shipped to me, and it looked amazing. And then they lowered it. They brought it into my driveway. Then I looked inside and went, oh my God. Well, it is what it is. It's the money they gave me. Yeah. And we made the best of it, but it was one of the more fun ideas I think I ever came up with. And again, for a station that really struggled with its ratings, it was a fun little side project. So it's kind of a glimpse of just showing my appreciation for that era of a vehicle, for not being a gearhead. Again, I wouldn't know how to fix or do anything with these. In fact, that WLOL Chevelle on day one did break down, and I did get myself in some trouble because I didn't have my driver's license on me or proof of insurance or license plates. And that's a story for another day.
Oh my God.
And it was an interesting way to start a Sunday morning after it being delivered across the country from New York. But
what a dumbass.
Muscle cars are badass, period.
They are. Do you remember what year? I do remember that Chevelle. I was working at a different radio station. We were still with the same ownership group, so we were still coworkers, but different stations. So I remember that promotion very well, but I don't remember the year. Do you remember by chance what year?
I want to say it was a 71,
okay,
or 72. It was still kind of that classic rounded body shape.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And it was really cool. It roared. I mean, once, yeah. And then we got it fixed up and running really good. Interior kind of was what it was, but the guy who did win it, was still pretty damn excited.
Yeah. I mean, if he gets a Chevelle and all he has to do is spend a little bit of time, and maybe he's one of those guys that likes to fix things up anyway, he could do the interior himself if he wants or spend some money to get it done. Yeah. I'm sure he appreciated it. I got a quick Chevelle story, but before I do that, I'm going to go backwards on you a little bit. And do you know who was the main guy responsible for developing the GTO?
I do not.
It's John DeLorean. He worked for, he was one of the Pontiac designers. And of the famous DeLorean. Early in his career, he was with Pontiac, and he was responsible, him and his team were responsible for designing and building GTOs. And so in the mid-60s.
The joke's on him. He didn't design the Chevelles to go, or the GTO, I'm sorry, to go 88 miles an hour and bring it no. back in time. So clearly he got better at creating vehicles the older he got.
Some of those 60s era GTOs could go pretty damn fast, though. I can tell you that they were badass muscle cars, no doubt about it. Before I go on with my, I guess we're on to my last pick now. Before I touch on that, because you mentioned the Chevelle and spent so much time, I have to bring this up. My friend, who you know, my friend Justin, he was born in a 1969 Chevelle.
Really?
Yeah, it was. And to this day, that's always been his dream car. He's never owned one, but I think that if you were to ask him what muscle car he wants, that's what he would, you know, why wouldn't you? You'd want like a 69 Chevelle SS with those racing stripes, like you mentioned, probably.
Let's open the phone lines and take donations so Justin can get the vehicle he was born in.
Yeah. For God's sake. Let's get him his damn car. Well, wait a minute. Don't forget me though. Can't we do both? Yeah. Don't be a dick.
Oh God!
Yeah. Anyway, well, I mean, a good transition from the Chevelle talk, because Chevelle actually is not on my list, but it was a very good honorable mention. I really did love those 69, 70 Chevelles, again in that late 60s muscle car era. But the last pick on my list is not a Chevelle; it is a Chevy. It's actually a 1962 Chevy Corvette. Oh, and Corvettes are cool.
Hot car.
And you know, there are car guys out there going to be saying, "How can this guy have a Chevy and a Ford both on his list?" You know, and I'm like, you know, screw you, first of all. Whenever people say that I only like Fords, I'm not going to drive a Chevy. How can somebody who loves Fords look at a Corvette and think that's an ugly car? You know what I mean? Or how can you look at, how can you be a Chevy guy and look at that 70 Mustang 429 and think that car sucks.
They're just people who should have to run around being labeled an anus.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
People exactly. get that worked up about it's got to be this brand. It's got to be that brand. Anus.
Get over yourself. That's what I say.
Because there's a lot. Because, well, first, I'm going to a question about your Corvette pick. Is it a hard top or a convertible? Do you have a specific like choice?
I probably would go with a convertible, but I wouldn't complain about the hard tops either. And one of the main reasons why I picked the 63 or 62 Corvette is that's kind of the first year that they came out with the 327 V8 engine. And that was the first time they'd had that in the Corvette. Previously, the Corvettes, that's what people don't realize. The first Corvettes came out in 1953, and they were sort of modeled after European sports cars, the little small MG type, Triumph type sports cars, and Jaguars, that kind of thing. And the reason why they did that is because, you know, GIs, soldiers from World War II were coming back to the United States, and they were buying these little European cars they'd seen over there and shipping them here and having them brought here. And Chevy's like, well, let's take advantage of that and make our own American car that kind of looks like that. But the problem was the first few years of the Corvette were they had no balls. I mean, they didn't put big engines, and they're not the Corvettes that we think of today at all. They were small, little, sporty looking things, but they didn't have a lot of pep, and they weren't really all that popular. Their color options were kind of limited. By the late 50s, it got better, and then into the 60s, the engines got bigger. It became the Corvette that we all know. In fact, the 1962 Corvette was the biggest selling Corvette up to that point. It's outsold any of the other previous years. So that year sort of solidified it as the American icon that we all think of the Corvette as being. And I mean, you mentioned at the top of the show, Little Red Corvette. I mean, how many songs and movies and TV shows have featured Corvettes over the years?
Well, I believe there's only one song called Little Red Corvette. I could be wrong.
Yeah. Okay. But again, as I said, how many songs and TV shows and movies have referenced Corvettes over the years?
They're a staple to, you know, the American automobile scene, clearly.
Yeah.
I struggled with not putting a Corvette on my list. It was not the model that you chose. I was really close to putting a 69 Corvette Stingray on. Just because I've always loved that long, like overly dramatic hood. And they're so unique looking. They're cool. Again, they're like little Batmobiles.
Yeah.
You're right. Who can say they don't love a Corvette? And again, that's a Chevy.
Yeah. I don't drive. I only like Dodge. Corvettes suck. Boo you.
Screw you, creepo.
Screw you.
So that was your last one, right?
Yeah, I mean, I got a couple of American classics, American hypercar that no one's ever heard of, and then a European Ferrari.
This is a real pick, and I know it's going to go way off the grain of like the kind of cars we've just been discussing. But my last pick, it's a 2006 International CXT 4x4 truck. Now, XT means Extreme Truck Series. And for those of you who don't know what these are, again, pull the Google machine out and look up an International XT truck. And these are the world's largest mass-produced retail trucks ever made. And they were only made for a four-year window from 2004 to 2008. They were made by a company called Navistar. That's a Texas-based company. Imagine that, the whole everything's bigger in Texas. Well, they really took that serious when it came to making this truck. To give you an idea of how like big it is, they weigh 7 tons.
What?
It's basically like a semi truck with an extended cab, but instead of like the truck being set up to pull trailers, it actually has a pickup bed truck with a hydraulic lift that lifts up. Here's a quick story. I don't have like a ton of details about it in front of me, but I do remember like reading some stories about back when Mr. Ashton Kutcher became kind of a big deal and probably got his hands on a lot of money and was getting his fame and so on and so forth. He also was one of these guys, one of these celebrities that was very like, hey, everyone, go green. Let's save the planet. And then people found out that he has one of these trucks. he caught a lot of shit for it They're like, what a hypocrite. He got jumped on. Because of this specific truck. And again, look it up. The specific year that I liked, it would be, again, in the color black. And I would get, like, really cool just black wheels put on this, and it would look about as scary as and as intimidating as a street vehicle that would be legal could ever be because of its size. And just, it's so high, you're so high off the ground, like a semi driver, that, well, again, king of the road type stuff here.
Yeah. Our regular listeners know we don't know each other's picks. And when you mentioned that truck, I'm like, I don't know what the hell you're talking about. And so I Googled it right now and I'm looking at it. Our listeners, they do need to either Google it or, like I said, go to our YouTube channel and watch our video there so they can see a picture of it. This thing looks like a semi truck, but instead of the back part where you'd hook up the trailer, there's a bed, like a bed, exactly. A pickup bed. That's literally what it is. It's got the giant gas tank on below the doors, you know, like semi trunks.
Oh no, God. The big dually tires in the back. I mean, again, this is, it's like a semi truck.
It's asinine is what this thing is.
It is a little over the top, but again, it's a dream vehicle.
It is.
And if you could afford to, I don't even know where you would find something like this now. Cause again, they were only manufactured and made for 4 years. And clearly they went away because I think they got like 8 miles per gallon.
Oh, I'm surprised even that. That's downhill.
But again, it would just be fun. If I were like a true Jay Leno type and had this giant collection of vehicles, you're damn right I would have a truck like this represented.
CXT, right? That's what it is, the CXT.
Yeah.
I just saw people talk about towing capacity. You know, people, is my pickup going to be able to tow my boat? Is it going to be able to tow my camper? This thing can tow 20 tons. So,
So you're all set. You're all set for that weekend trip up to the cabin.
I think it'll handle your boat. I think it'll handle your pontoon.
You could have like a long caravan of what you're pulling.
This thing is something else. Yeah, people have to take a look at this thing. It's amazing. But
it's incredibly obnoxious. And that's why I like it.
Yeah, no, I'll give you that. If you're dreaming, dream big.
An obnoxious pick from an obnoxious man.
on an obnoxious podcast, as a matter of fact. So it all ties together.
Nothing has been more truer than that statement. But again, this is a fun one.
Did you have any, I know you mentioned that you kind of considered, what was a 69 Corvette. Did you have any other honorable mentions you wanted to throw out there, or does that kind of cover what you had?
You know, that really covers it, because I wanted to stay with, that's the thing. These are dream cars, and I wanted to focus on stuff the way it was kind of manufactured.
Yeah.
I mean, I could get in, I could get off track and start talking about getting like some chopper customized, that's, but I wanted, we both did that. We stuck with cars.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, and okay, I threw on one truck, but big, sue me.
Yeah, or even like a tricked out RV that had all the bells and whistles, that we avoided that kind of stuff.
Yeah, but I think the Chevelle is probably the one, and we already talked about it, that's and the Stingray from 69, those are the two truly best, highest honorable mention ones on my list. For the most part, when you look at our list and you look at the expense of what these vehicles cost, I mean, yeah, these are people with FU money that have stuff like this. Yeah. I think you should share a story that you just told me this week as we were getting ready for this topic. Something you witnessed about a guy down in your neck of the woods and what you saw in the news.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you mentioned FU money, and this is a perfect example of that. I'll give the quick version of the story. So essentially this was a TV news story the other day I was watching, and there was some rich guy. I live in the Phoenix area, and there's some rich guy, I'm sure, who had a brand new Ferrari that he wanted to show off, and in addition to that, he was having a big party. But his party was taking place on the rooftop of a hotel. They had a big party deck on this hotel, and he wanted to show off his Ferrari, not to people on the ground as they were walking into the hotel. No, that's not good enough. He wanted the Ferrari on the rooftop deck of this hotel so that all his partygoers can marvel at it and see it up close. And so he hired a massive crane, and they had to create this contraption to lift the Ferrari with this massive crane up to the top of like a 12 or a 15 story hotel, if I remember right. It was way the hell up in the air, and they had it on the news. They showed the thing flying through the air on this crane lift. It was wild. It was really, really wild. But again, FU money, because this guy, he's like, I want to have a party, I want to have it on the roof, and I want my car up there. So I can only imagine what he spent just to have a crane come out and customize this little apparatus to lift the damn car all the way up to the top.
And remind me too, you said you knew what he paid for the Ferrari too. Wasn't it like insane?
Yeah. Well, it was like a $4 or $5 million Ferrari, I think. And I don't know enough about Ferraris to know the model, you know, specs on it, but it was a very expensive car, you know, and you know, and of course you wouldn't put a Yugo up there. Of course, if you're going to go through the trouble, you're going to put a
Yugo. Okay, so, that's a different direction.
Yeah, I mean that's different FU money to spend that kind of money to put a Yugo on. Yeah,
you're on the other side of the FU if you're driving a Yugo.
That's F me is what that is.
F me, F you.
That's F me money.
But no, I can't imagine the sweaty ass you would have if you just spent $4 or $5 million on a Ferrari and now you hired a company to lift it up on top of a building.
Yeah.
I don't think, I mean, what, okay, but you're right. Talk about FU money. When you start thinking of and conjuring up ideas like that, just to have it basically be a party favor and like a little way to brag. Look at my new car.
Yeah.
And then everyone, how do you get it up here?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. It's a talking point for people. And then he's like, well, I'm really rich. That's how I got it up there.
Exactly. Small pee-pee syndrome. And I know because I just picked a 7-ton truck.
You damn right, wise ass.
Yes, exactly. Oh, so, no.
This was a fun episode. Again, a pretty visual one. So I can't say it enough. Check these out. And I bet this is one that I definitely encourage. Start trolling the internet looking for what would be your 4 dream cars. So again, please, you know, check out our website. Please subscribe and follow us. That way we plan to, and for the most part, we're going to continue to release an episode a week. It's kind of been the pace we've been on.
Yeah.
And we love the feedback. We love the interaction. We love the comments. Until next time, friends, I will thank our sponsor for this episode. This one's close to home and close to my heart. Thank you, CC Wings.